these worms. So brief background, but I don't need to tell the people in the audience here much about this, but just to say that there are a large number of people at risk of these infections, which are onchocerciasis and lymphatic filariasis, caused by Onchocerca volvulus, phenomatosarcosis, and Wiltshire Mycrofti and the Bruchia species for lymphatic filariasis, and severely disabling diseases. And the problems that we have with these, although there's been some great strides in terms of elimination for these diseases, there are still some hurdles that are difficult to overcome to reach those elimination goals, and that is mainly because current drugs that are used for the control programs only target the larval stages, the microfilariae of the parasites, that are largely ineffective against the adult worms. There are safety constraints, as Ivan alluded to earlier, with regards to LOA-LOA, because this can actually cause fatal adverse events if people have high levels of LOA-LOA in their blood when they're given ivermectin. And there's also emerging resistance to existing drugs. So a bit about Wolbachia and why we're so interested in it. Well, basically we know from a lot of studies that Wolbachia, these are these endosymbiotic bacteria, they're found, this is a cross-section of a female Onchocerca worm. You can see these red stained bacteria in the hypodermal cords of the worm. They're also found within the developing embryos. So we know that they're needed for embryogenesis and larval development. We also know that they contribute to the adult worm longevity. This is a major barrier, the length of time that these worms live for. This is why the drug programs at the moment have to give the MDA for such an extended period, because these adult worms live for a long time. We also do know that the Wolbachia actually contribute to disease pathogenesis, both through severe adverse events when worms are killed, the microfilariae are killed and release inflammatory components, and also clinical disease. So if you give 4 weeks of doxycycline, a broad-spectrum antibiotic, you can sterilise the adult worm, so they cannot produce microfilariae because of this problem with this need for Wolbachia for embryogenesis, and also blocks transmission, because any Wolbachia, any microfilariae that are released that don't have Wolbachia aren't able to undergo development in the mosquito. Then if you treat with this doxycycline, the adult worms actually can die 1 to 2 years after treatment. This is a slow death once they have lost their endosymbionts, they're not getting all the things that they need from them, and they die quite a protracted death, which is actually a good, delivers a good safety profile. So it's macrofilaricidal. And we also know that doxycycline improves pathology, all through skin disease, bronchiectasis, also hydrocele lymphedema for LF. An important point is that this kind of treatment is safe in LOA-LOA endemic areas, because LOA-LOA does not have Wolbachia bacteria, so it would be unaffected by this treatment. But why can't we be out there now using it? And it's because of a long course of treatment, so it takes 4 to 6 weeks. And also, doxycycline is contraindicated in pregnancy and children under 9. So AWOL, the consortium, the Anti-Wolbachia Consortium, was formed in 2007 to address these issues. And obviously 10 years is a long time in research, so I'm not going to have the chance to go through everything with you today. I just wanted to give you the highlights, give you the message of why we feel this is important, and also to highlight some of the new things that we're doing off the back of AWOL. So we have a screening funnel for drug discovery and development. We have these go and no-go criteria. Our screening starts with the cell-based screen, which I'll just highlight in the next slide to show you exactly how we do that. This has evolved over time. We originally had a 9-day assay with quantitative PCR and a 96 well plate, but now we can use 3-4 well plates and have a 7-day assay. We then move into in vivo models, and we're looking for a larval mouse model, which is a 14-day readout, and this is really trying to target and get a quick readout to see whether something is worth progressing into the more protracted adult bruise or sprain in the mouse. So we're targeting the L3 to L4 stage, so seeing whether they're able to develop, and you get a quick readout from that. And we're always looking for greater than 90% Wolbachia reduction, because we have evidence from the trials that have been done with doxycycline that if you reach that threshold, you're leading to a macrophylaricidal activity. And all of this is enforced by PK sampling and PK/PD modelling throughout, so that we're not progressing things that you have to give a really high dose in the mouse, and then we don't understand how that translates to the human situation. And then ultimately, what we're looking for in trials is a 75% reduction in treatment time course, so moving from 4 weeks to 1 week. And this is all aligned with our target product profile for an anti-Wolbachia macrophylaricide that has 7 days or less treatment with oral delivery. And I just wanted to highlight, because I'll mention it now in terms of our screens, that we actually refined this workflow from what we did originally. Originally, we had an in vitro worm assay here, and we took it out because basically everything that was in here translated into the larval model. Then we started screening more and more drugs and realised actually we need another way to triage the hits. So we had lots of hits, we needed to triage them, but also it was a way to confirm worm penetration. So if we moved something into the larval model and it didn't work, we then would wonder, is it because it didn't work, or is it because it just didn't get across the cuticle of the worm? So we're confirming that. We also confirm that it's a target in the worm Wolbachia, because their initial screen is done in an insect-based system. And we're also now able to do some other analyses, which I'll move on to speak about later. So just briefly, what our screening is we have a cell line that has Wolbachia in it. It's a mosquito cell line with mosquito Wolbachia. And we have an image-based operator system. We can screen thousands and thousands of compounds this way. But as I said, this is probably about 3 or 4 years worth of Babel was developing this assay from our original screen, which was qPCR. So we're now in a much higher throughput place now. But we also reintroduced this microflare screen, which is much lower throughput, so that's about 20 compounds a week, theoretically, we can do. But this is a similar system where we can actually get EC50 analysis to find out how effective the hits that we find against the cells, the most promising hits we find against the cells, are in terms of their effect on the Wolbachia of microflare. And overall, we've screened against the cells over 2 million compounds, and we have over 20,000 hits. We also have our in vivo efficacy models, and basically what we do is, this is the larval screen, so this is the quick readout, which is 2 weeks. And what we're looking for, as you see with doxycycline, is you see this reduction in Wolbachia surface protein copy number, so this is a qPCR readout. So that just shows you that the Wolbachia has been reduced. You also see an effect on L4 length, because they're not able to develop fully without the Wolbachia. Then moving into the adult model, it's a lot longer time frame, which is why we always filter through this first, but it's easier to get a readout of this, so things that come through here don't necessarily make it to being good hits at the end of this, but what we're looking for here is a reduction again in WSP, and you can also see the reduction in MF because of the hit on embryogenesis. So the first thing we did with AWOL was to test all the registered drugs, the human pharmacopoeia, which actually is surprisingly little, it's only around 2,600 drugs. Back then in 2007-2008 when we started. We did this in combination with a company called Combinatorix. We then were also doing some small-scale anti-infective library screening from all of these different partners. I just wanted to highlight really what we've got, the most important things that we got out of this early screening, which was when we did the combinatorics screen, the human pharmacopoeia, the sort of usual suspects came out that we knew about, so tetracyclines and rifamycins, which we already knew were effective against Wolbachia. The fluoroquinolones have been tested previously. There have been some discrepancies between the different systems that had been published before, but they came out as being good hits against Wolbachia. Then from Abbott, who then became AbbVie, we got the Tylosin product that we that Ivan from DNDi spoke about earlier. So what we did next was to take those tetracyclines, rifamycins, and fluoroquinolones and move them into the drug development programme of AWOL, whereas the HITs entered HIT-to-lead-and-lead optimisation in the discovery programme. So just to give you some highlights about rifampicin. So we knew, as I said, that rifampicin was had good potency in vitro and in vivo models, but this didn't translate to clinical trials, because there had been clinical trials done with rifampicin and it hadn't resulted in the expected result. And we tried to establish whether this was down to a human mouse mismatch, and we heard a bit about that problem with schisto as well. And actually it was found that through PK/PD modelling that in humans there is lower exposure than there are in mouse, so you don't get exposed to as much of the drug. And we've done some further work to show that if you use the clinically standard rifampicin dose, which was primarily defined in the past by the fact that rifampicin was only semi-synthetic and so was very expensive, so the actual dose used was based on that, and you only get a 58% reduction of Wolbachia. However, if you do the high dose of rifampicin, then you get a 96% reduction in Wolbachia. Furthermore, we've also done some combinations of antibiotics with albendazole, which is one of the standard antifilarial drugs, and found that if you combine rifampicin with albendazole, then it can actually produce synergy. So if I just highlight here the difference between using the standard dose, which is the 5, and the mouse is 5 mg per kg, and it doesn't get over this 90% threshold, but if you add the albendazole into the mix, then some of the worms are crossed over onto this 90% threshold. So we've managed to define that high dose rifampicin and rifampicin plus albendazole meet our TPP of 7 days of treatment. Going back to the Tylosin analogues, we went through some lead optimization with that. So as we found out earlier, that Tylosin itself, although a veterinary antibiotic, has very low bioavailability. So when you give it IP, you get this great reduction in Wolbachia. However, if you give it orally, you don't get the reduction. So initially we were thinking of changing the formulation, but then they got a chemist out of retirement who fancied about making some analogues of this, and this was very successful. We tested around 150 of them and found two analogues with improved potency and PK, which were selected for characterisation. So you can see that they've crossed the threshold here at 7 days treatment. And this is now known as Tylomac with AbbVie, and as we heard earlier, this is actually now in safety trials in volunteers. So these analogues meet the TPP as well with 7 days over treatment. In terms of other things that we've done, so those initial hits that I described there have come through the human pharmacopoeia and focused library screening, where it was all done on quite a small scale. They were anti-infective libraries, so we had some sort of inclination that things would come out of that. And then we went on to using more diversity-based libraries to try and find things that we would never even have thought of testing in the first place. And we screened the 10,000 soft focus library from BioFocus. We've drained £500,000 from the MMV library, which is medicines for malaria venture. And we also have had a really successful collaboration with AstraZeneca, where we screened a complete portfolio of 1.3 million compounds. And this was done by basically seconding Rachel, who sat up there for a year to AstraZeneca, where we developed the screen further to be an industrialised scale screen to be able to screen all these compounds. And to highlight what has come out of this, first of all, Tylenax have already described. The BioFocus library led to six series, so completely novel chemistry in the Antimobacillus field, including template one, which is AWZ1066, which we heard is now in the portfolio as macrofluoricides as well. We found five series from the MMV library. One of those was fusidic acid, which is another registered antibiotic that we didn't know worked against Wolbachia before. We've done some work around this, but I don't have time to go into that in detail today. And then finally, from the 1.3 million compounds, we got lots and lots of hits from AstraZeneca, but we even managed to sort of titrate that down to 20 diverse structures with what is of interest now. And we're also still processing through the 68,000 global health chemical diversity library, which we have 185 hits from. So just to talk a bit more about these aspects of the hits that we have and how we're going forward in terms of finding out a bit more about them. So I described the microfilary assay earlier, why we've reintroduced it as a means to triage the large number of hits that we had. But it's also proven very useful in terms of discriminating between very good hits before they go into the in vivo models. So our normal assay is using these Ruja microfilary. We treat them on day zero, and then we remove the microfilary at day six, extract DNA, do qPCR. Basically, the result we get with doxycycline and any good hits is that they reach an 80% reduction in Wolbachia. We then have introduced this new system where we're looking at the dynamics of this kill of the Wolbachia, where we wash off the drug at day two, and we have also done shorter time frames as well, and then remove the drug at day six, remove the microfilary at day six. And what we found, which is really interesting, is that all these nicely bright coloured ones on the left hand side are the AstraZeneca clusters, and you can see in the dotted line here is showing you the 80% reduction that we would normally see at day six. When you wash off the drug at day two, you are still able to achieve this 80% reduction, and this is the case also for template one, which is or 1066 compound. Not quite the case for Tylenac, and also all the known antibiotics that we know work against Wolbachia aren't able to achieve this 80% reduction with only 2 days of treatment. We have actually gone less, and it looks like it's somewhere sort of 12 hours plus that we can start to see some really good activity with these compounds. So we have five AstraZeneca clusters and AWZ1066 that have accelerated kill profiles, which suggests a different mode of action. So the key to this is that when you're only looking at D6, they all perform exactly the same. So all of these will be down here at D6, but if you wash the drug off at day two, only these AstraZeneca compounds and 1066 have this accelerated reduction in Wolbachia. So we're interested in researching this a bit more to see what's going on, because they have a different mode of action. And aligned with that, we also are doing some target identification work. So you were being asked, Eliana, earlier on about, do you know the targets? And this is where we're going to now, because actually you don't need to know the target when you're doing these phenotypic screens, just trying to find things that work. But now we're at a point where things are going through regulatory approval, and these are the kind of questions you get asked, is what do they actually target? So unfortunately, Wolbachia is genetically intractable, which makes it difficult to actually do sort of genetic target identification processes. So we are currently using a chemical proteomics approach with photoreactive probes that we've made to 1066 in Tyrolac, and we're hoping to take this forward with our other hits that we have. But just to highlight the process, so basically what you do is you incubate cells, and we're also extending this work with the worms, where you incubate with your probe, which looks very much like your drug, but has like this click handle on it. And you incubate, you compare that to DMSO. You use UV light to create a covalent bond with your probe and your target proteins. And then you're able to do pull downs because you attach biotin and you can pull it down with beads. And also you can look at in-gel fluorescence to see what binding, and also perform mass spec to identify the proteins that have been pulled down in this approach. And what we're just an example of some of our results, where you have proteins that are enriched with the probe but not with the DMSO. So we're following this up just now in collaboration with Imperial College London and AMPI, and the chemists at University of Liverpool who are making the probes. So just to summarise at the end, so when we started this consortium in 2007, we had only one drug, which was a proof of concept drug, and now we have this portfolio where we have doxycycline is now being used in particular areas in terms of policy. And we have some other proof of concept drugs, and we now have all these candidates that we're hoping to take forward. And Tyrolac is, as I said, in the DMDI portfolio in phase one trials. We also have all of these things to back up, but like we've been talking about earlier, the funding for this part is not really there at the moment, so that's the difficulty if there's attrition down the pipeline. And there is a cast of thousands.